It's time now for Keeping It Real with Ollie Gann. Brought to you by Cox Farm Service on Magic 105.5 WMGH. Now, here's your host, Ollie Gann.
When it comes to homosexuality, bisexuality, or being transgender, there has been a lot of changing in people's perception over the years. Just a generation ago, these matters were widely seen as wrong. A half generation ago, they were seen maybe as tolerable, just as the hit TV series Seinfeld proclaimed, not that there's anything wrong with that, a reference to an individual engaged in a homosexual lifestyle. Nowadays, we have the LGBT community viewed largely as acceptable and even appealing. Why the change? Is this a big deal? What does this mean for the future ahead? These questions will be asked of my special guest for today, as well as many personal questions will be asked too. The special guest is Gwen, a 14-year-old girl who, believe it or not, has had certain experiences with the subject matter at hand. I do want to issue the warning that certain content within this edition of the show may be inappropriate for younger audiences, but I greatly urge all who are Gwen's age and older to tune into today's show, as it's one you don't want to miss.
There's no death, there's no height that can stand in your way. Not even doubt or my mistakes. You broke the walls and tore apart the veil. And what can separate us?
Okay, and this is Keeping It Real, and I'm your host, Ollie G, and we have another loaded show here today with a subject matter that is very much in the news. It is very much a part of discussion with a lot of people's lives, particularly those that are maybe, say, 30 and younger, that 13 to 30-year-old age bracket. And I have a guest with me here today who is 14 years of age and will have a lot to say about this, not only from personal experience, but also through her interaction with peers as well, I'm sure of it. So, Gwen, I want to welcome you to Keeping It Real here today. All smiles, and there are lots of reasons for smiles, but none other bigger reason than Jesus Christ, which I know that you are going to be talking about here today. But I don't want to put the cart before the horse. I want to get into asking you kind of some introductory questions. You have had some bisexual tendencies or thoughts, experiences in the past. When did you start having them? What was the appeal for it, if you don't mind sharing with the listening audience?
Okay, well, I guess I had always had these kind of thoughts. They had been in and out throughout my life. I remember the first crush I ever had was on a girl. I was like 3, and I didn't know what it meant. So I ended up asking my mom, who she's a drug addict, so she's been in and out of my life as well. And before I knew this, I was too young to know all of that. So I asked her, and the way it came out, it was the weirdest way. I asked her why it had to be a boy and a girl to have a baby, and why it couldn't be boys and boys or girls and girls. And she wouldn't fully answer my question because, again, I was like 3. So in my head, I just made up my own answers. And throughout my life, I didn't really ever question it again until I was around like 12 or 13, because I had friends who started questioning their sexualities who knew more than I did. And by then, I knew what it meant to be gay or bisexual or transgender, even slightly. I knew what it was. And my friends started questioning their sexualities and their orientations, and they started asking me. So I started questioning it as well. And I remember back in 2016, Pulse nightclub shooting, and I was faced with the decision, well, are you gay? Are you bisexual? Are you straight? What are you? Because you need to figure this out soon. And for me, the appeal was that, I've always liked girls. I just didn't know what it meant. And at my age, it makes more sense. Girls are a lot prettier than boys. They smell a lot better. They use deodorant. They're not idiots. So for me growing up, I always just thought...
I don't smell, do I?
Not too bad.
Okay, good.
Not that I know of. I haven't really sniffed you.
So. Good, good. Well, I just want to make sure because I didn't want to gross you out, or if I needed to hit the showers real quick, I'd be sure to do that.
That was always just how I thought about it. Growing up without a mom, I had room in my heart for a woman. So I thought, psychologically, this also makes sense. And it's healthy if I were to be in a relationship with a woman.
Okay. So you shared a lot of information there right off the jump here. I'm telling you, it's amazing to me at 14 years of age how you are not shy, you're not bashful when it comes to being transparent about this stuff. What would you say was the primary reason as to you having these sorts of tendencies? Was it a lack of education? Was it just kind of like a fad amongst a number of your peers or friends of yours? Or was it media? Was it what was going on social media? What kind of got you going in this direction, you think?
Well, I think it could be a lot of things. For me, yes, it was my friends had some influence. And also, without having a mom, without having a woman to guide me in the way that I should be with my gender and sexual orientation and all of that, I didn't really know what to do.
Right.
I guess people always say, are you born that way? Is that why you like a specific gender? Is that why you're bisexual or gay or whatever? And for me, I had always felt kind of the attraction. And I was just at the age where I could exploit it the most and that I could finally embrace it.
All right. Well, look, I want to encourage all of you out there listening. I'm telling you, if you haven't been able to tell, this is going to be a jam-packed show today. I encourage everyone to keep it here to Magic 105.5 WMGH as well as KIR Radio. If that's the outlet that you're using to listen to this edition of the show, please listen to this show in its entirety, if at all possible, because we've got a lot more with Gwen here on Keeping It Real today.
I fickle my heart and how woozy my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. Now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. Lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes, I can change what you see. Your soul you must keep totally free. Ha, ha. Ha, ha. Ha, ha. Ha, ha. In these bodies we will live. In these bodies we will die. Where you invest your love, You invest your life in these bodies, we will live. In these bodies, we will die. Where you invest your love, you invest your life.
Here on Keeping It Real, I'm your host, Ollie G, and the song that we just heard is called Awake My Soul by Mumford & Sons, and yes, not a quote-unquote contemporary Christian selection, but we have oftentimes put in song selections that are fitting for the message or the subject matter at hand in a particular edition of the show, and that is what has happened here, a selection picked by my special guest, Gwen. Why did you pick that song?
Well, the song Awake My Soul really hits to my heart. It's like it tells the story of a person who, it doesn't outright say that this person is struggling with their belief in God and with their path in life, but it just describes the story of this person who struggles and falls. But the bridge actually goes, where you invest your love, you invest your life. And I believe in investing my life and my love in God. And I think that that's the underlying message of the song. So it might not be outright, but sometimes God works in little hints.
Sure, absolutely. As you were having bisexual experiences, what were you feeling emotionally? Was there fear? Was there confusion? Did you have joy? What was going through your emotional being as you were having these tendencies and as they were evolving?
Well, it was kind of a whirlwind. I felt a lot of different emotions. I felt a lot of fear at first. I was scared that people would judge me. My main fear was that God would judge me because growing up.
So even through all of this, you really had an awareness of God.
Yep. I remember all the questions coming into my head, like, what will people feel about this? How do you feel about this? Is this even real? Are you gay? Are you straight? Are you bi? What are you? How does God feel about this? That was the one thought that just got into me the most. And as I started going more into it, I would feel, if I took God out of the equation, I was feeling like I was king of the world. I felt like, oh my God, this is so much freedom right here. I can do whatever I want. Girls are really pretty, and now I can talk to them the way I want to. So I was feeling a bunch of different feelings.
Okay, so it would be fair to say then your emotional being was all over the map. It was kind of everywhere.
Yeah, the case is the same for most people who struggle with their sexuality. They feel the entire spectrum of emotions. They think, oh, I'm really happy because I'm finding out who I am, or oh, I'm really sad because people might judge me, oh, I'm really scared because people might find out. And I don't know whether or not that's a good or a bad thing.
Yeah, that actually leads me to my next question. Was this aspect of your life private? Or if so, for how long was it private? For how long of a season of your life? What happened when other people found out about it?
It was never really private with me. I remember mentioning earlier that it was friends who asked me. And to that I kind of responded, I guess, like, it wouldn't hurt for me to like a girl. And then as I began thinking more into it, I knew that I needed to tell my dad. I knew that I needed to go to him and ask him all the questions I had because he was the only person I really trusted to answer.
How old were you at that time then?
I was 12, I think. About 12 and a half.
12. So you're 14 now, 12 and a half. Yeah. I just want people to understand that the time frame here, it's fairly recent. This is all pretty short span of time. So What was your dad's response?
Well, I asked him that mean question. I asked, will God still love me if I like girls? And he said, of course, God will always love you. So then we kind of followed into all my other questions. How will other people feel about this? Is this really real? My dad tried to help me as best as he could through all of that. And I started coming out to more people because I was getting more comfortable with it. I came out to some friends. I remember I said to a friend once, I'm like, hey, because it was really hard for me to put a label on it for so long. I was like, am I gay or am I bisexual? I know I like girls. Boys are okay. So I just said to my friend, I'm like, hey, I'm gay. And she goes, oh, cool, me too. And I'm like, what?
So then was there a sense of connection there?
Yes, yeah. Of course. That friend was like totally feeling the exact same way I had. And we grew better friends through that. We were like, yo, I get you. You get me. We understand all these same feelings that we're having. We can help each other through this. That's cool. And I came out to other friends. And most of my friends, they were either incredibly supportive or I didn't get them one by one, one-on-one. And I didn't say, this is how I feel. They just got it. Because I would say it out loud in front of a group of people. I would express an attraction for girls in front of them.
Right, right. So then would it be fair to say that it was very important for you to feel like you were understood?
Yeah. It was like I was creating a tally list in my head. Like the more people who know, the better it is, the more comfortable I'll get with this, and the closer I'll be to getting a girlfriend. Because the more people who know, the more available I seem. Because that was my main goal. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to get a girlfriend. So I thought the more people who knew, better. And the more understood I would be by my friends.
What then happened regarding your relationships with your parents or other family people? You told your dad, you mentioned how he responded or how he answered a couple of your questions, but then moving more forward, what was the dynamics change? Did things seem awkward or did they seem normal to you? What was that like?
For some reason, I had the notion in my head that this would help me and my dad grow stronger together in our relationship, because I've always had a good relationship with my dad. He's always kind of been there for me through everything that's happened in my life. He's always been there. He's like been my rock. And I thought that this will help us grow closer because he understands having an attraction for women. Therefore, I'll be like a son to him, kind of, and he'll help me with that. When it came to my mom, I mentioned earlier, she's a drug addict. So she was doing better at the time. She had been clean for a couple of years, and she didn't live near me. She lived a while away. She still lived in America, just didn't live near me. So I called her one night because I just felt like I needed to tell her because it had been months and I'd gone so far into it. And I was just like, I need to tell my mom, because at the basis of it, I was kind of almost mostly scared of how she would feel about it. Because my relationship with her, I felt was a root of the way I felt for other women.
Wow.
Because I didn't have her as much in my life. So for some reason, I really, really felt like I needed to tell her. And when I did, I got on the phone with her and it took me like 5 minutes to finally get it out. I'm like, Mom, I have to tell you something. And she's like, okay, what is it? And it took me like 5 minutes of ums and ahs, like, would it be okay with you if I was bisexual? And she said, of course, I thought you were in jail or something. And I'm like, no, it's not that bad. And she's like, why would you be afraid to tell me? And I'm like, well, Mom, we don't really have a relationship. You're kind of really far away. And she's like, but of course we have a relationship. I'm right here. I'm listening to you. And I'm like, not really.
I mean, there's a lot going on here. Yeah. I mean, I'm 43 years old, and this is a lot for me to process. I can't even imagine what you're looking to process at age 12, 13, when all of this is going down. But I encourage the listening audience to keep it here, because we've got a lot more with Gwen, and we're going to be getting into now how she transitioned from an alternative lifestyle to a Jesus lifestyle. And your face just lit up when I said that. Again, that's one of the counterproductive things of radio, is people don't get a chance to see facial expressions and innuendos. If people were to just see your face light up, they would just, I'm trying to fight back the tears myself a little bit. But we've got a lot more with Gwen and a lot more great music from Mariah Peters, John Waller, and Mercy Me as well. So keep it here to Keeping It Real.
Searched to find the meaning of this life, something that would fill my empty soul. Some believe a lie, choose darkness over light, but I will stand and let the whole world know. I choose Jesus. choose Jesus, the one who first chose me. I stand unashamed, trusting in one name, 'cause I have seen the cross and I believe. Oh, this choice comes out.
You're my treasure. us is not us. Anything less is not us. Anything else is not who we are.
Back here on Keeping It Real. The song that we just heard was called Identity by John Waller. And we are back here with Gwen, my very special guest on Keeping It Real here today. Title for today's show, Am I Bisexual? She has shared a lot of information, ins and outs of what she's gone through in just the last couple of years of her life. She is currently 14 years of age. She has recently here given her life to Christ. When I say recently, within about the last year or so, right?
Yes.
Okay. So you gave your life to Christ about a year ago or a little over a year ago. What did you see as the reason for you needing to do this? What was so appealing to you concerning the gospel message and the truth of Christ?
Well, for me, growing up, I'd always known there was a God. I just knew. It was at the core of my heart, I knew there was a God. I grew up in AA meetings with my dad and my mom, and I would hear these testimonies, and they wouldn't flat out say it was Jesus who saved them from their addiction and from their sin and everything that had happened. But you just heard it. It was something other than them, and I wanted that other. And whenever I would be hurt in my life, whenever my mom would leave or relapse or something like that, I always returned to God, and I returned to prayer. And I just knew that it was Him who would bring me through, and I would feel this incredible feeling in my heart of just healing, of just knowing that you are comforted, you are loved. And I didn't really grow up in church. We went to Sunday school for like a year. I went to a Christian preschool, but other than that, my life wasn't very Christian. We were spiritual.
Right.
I guess, quote unquote, spiritual. And I was presented with the gospel in a youth group because my family had just started going to church. And I was I was kind of uncomfortable because I was here kind of bisexual advocate. And my family starts going to a Southern Baptist church. And I'm like, oh, God.
And were you probably figuring that there weren't any bisexual, quote-unquote bisexual people in that youth group? Were you thinking you were the only one, or were you hoping you weren't the only one?
I was hoping there were some. There were some that I looked at and I'm like, you seem like you could question, but I'm not going to call you out on it because it's a danger for me to be here. You must be terrified as well. But growing through that, I actually got to know these people. And I'm like, nah, I made these assumptions about them and they're not very true. But for me, when I got saved, it was all new. It was all like, I didn't know that this was a decision I had to make. I didn't know that you had to accept Jesus Christ as your personal savior. I just thought you had to know the story and that was that.
Okay.
That, you know, you died, buried, rose again. That's all you got to know. I didn't know that it was an actual decision, a heart decision that you had to make.
So then did you make this heart decision at that particular time, or did it happen sometime afterwards? Going back to youth group, or?
I prayed the prayer of salvation. I said, God, I need you in my life. We did the whole heads bowed, eyes closed. I raised my hand and afterwards, I had heard this amazing gospel story, and I thought, how could it be that no one else in this room could, like, shouldn't all these kids in this room have raised their hands? Because this story is so amazing about what God has done for us. And then later I realized that all these kids were already saved. They had already heard the story, and it was all just so new to me.
Right.
So after the prayer, and everyone looked up again, the man who gave the gospel that night, he was all like, congratulations to the one who raised their hand.
Oh, boy.
I was so surprised. I didn't know that was a thing. I didn't know that people were going to talk about it.
You probably didn't know you were going to get put on the spot.
Not at all. And of course, the pastor who had preached that night and female youth counselor rushed in and grabbed me. And they had me sign the paper for the church and my email and stuff like that. Like, I'd been there that night. I got saved. And
so then this was the beginning of the journey of you moving from an alternative lifestyle and moving to a Jesus lifestyle.
I can remember as I prayed the prayer of salvation, I was saying, God, I'm a sinner, and I need you to forgive me of my sins. But in the back of my head, I was like, but not that one. Not the whole bisexuality thing, because that's not a sin. I've already argued it with myself. That's not a sin. That's totally fine. We don't need to touch on that. God, I just need Jesus.
Okay.
That's all we're doing tonight. Wrap it up. That's it.
Okay. So you continue to move along the road of life. Where were you then at the point where you realized that Jesus needed to forgive you of this as well, or that this needed to be a matter that needed closure in your life too?
Well, from the moment I got saved, I had this conviction that there still was something missing. Like, everyone always talks about getting saved and their life is just filled with all this hope and happiness and they're healed by God and they're just a complete person. But I didn't feel that way. I knew that I had gotten saved and I had a hope that I would get into heaven. But going through it, I knew there was something still missing. So I tried to blame it on the lust. I said, okay, God, I acknowledge this. I lust for women. That's not good. And I would continually pray that in my head. I have said the prayer of salvation like 30 times and said, God, I need you to forgive me of this sin. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. Please forgive me because I have messed it up. But it's not the fact that it's women that's the issue. It's just the fact that I can't control myself is the issue. And I asked God to send me a godly woman. I still wanted a girlfriend, but I wanted to have a Christian girlfriend this time around. And I wanted to make it as good as I could. Mm-hmm. When it came to still having the relationship that I wanted, but trying to make it godly. And that wasn't really going to work out.
Okay. So this was a process. Mm-hmm. Real quickly, at what point in time then did this whole matter really get right with the Lord?
I remember it was like one of the first opening nights of the college ministry.
When was that?
Okay. So I got saved in like January. So this was in like June, mid-June of that same year.
So about 7 months ago.
Yeah, but the person who spoke that night talked about judgment, and my main fear was being judged, but in that I also became a very judgmental person because I was trying to protect myself from judgment from other people and especially from God. So I would judge other people and I would judge God.
Okay.
But I felt so convicted in that message, and homosexuality was even mentioned in the message of how we shouldn't judge people who struggle with that, and I was just so broken down and shaking and so uncomfortable. God made me so uncomfortable with all the conviction I had that I finally bowed my head and I said, okay, God, I'm taking this chance. I'm going out on a limb here. I think I'm doing something wrong. It's not the lust that's always the issue. Yes, lust is wrong, but it's specifically the fact that I've chosen women over you. Mm. I have chosen trying to have a relationship with a woman over you. I haven't been doing what a saved person should do. I've been abusing your name. I've been abusing what you've done for me, and I'm sorry. And I need you to forgive me, and I need you to help me. I need you to help me through this, because if this is wrong, then I'm not going to get better on my own.
Well, I tell you what, we've got to go to commercial break. I want to come back before we make this show a wrap today. I've got another question or two for you here today. Definitely want to encourage everybody to keep it here, to keeping it real, because we've got a lot more with Gwen. Here is Good Grief by Eshon Burgundy, a rap selection. I hope all of you out there can tolerate this, but a selection brought on by Gwen, definitely relevant to her story, and especially her testimony of moving from an alternative lifestyle to a Jesus lifestyle.
Yeah. Some of the most unfortunate events have taken place inside my brain. I try to condense, but it expands when I explain. And that may sound intense, but that's just agony and pain that I casually contain. But magically it changed when I'm in front of everybody, yo. I laugh and joke, but I'd rather just go hang out in the lobby, though. Somebody asked me if I was paranoid one day. I guess it come off that way after seeing so much gunplay. Post-traumatic stress disorder, I don't know, but I guess so, sorta. Man, especially when I had my first daughter, and I ain't have a clue of what I could possibly do to support her. My pride kept me out of Burger King. May I take your order? The Lord will provide, even though I'm living my life less organized. An example of grace, not an excuse to make mistakes. I'm not abusing my faith, I'm just concluding what it takes. And that space is reserved for the one who died in my place. That burden get on my nerves, burden give me the shakes. That burden is heavy weight, that burden to make me break. And me giving it all away is me learning to levitate. Instead of a ski mask on my face, I'm just off in a better place. Let's pray.
I'm set free when I feel trapped. Can't let it live, gotta gotta kill that. No matter how hopeless, I can't deny that. There's a calm blue sky over our right. So let's hope.
Yeah, to be honest, I can't do nothing but believe the promise. No frontin', I'm just stuck on something only he can accomplish. I mean, the streets is in me deep, see, I done seen too much. So when things get tough, it's screaming to be released. And if I'm not preoccupied, those demons can be increased. That's verse 45, chapter 12 of Matthew. The least of my troubles, when I entertain the speech of the devil. So I remain in reach of the Father who applies heat to the kettle. So I scream when I blow off steam. Then I'm settled, reminded of the power in that name. Then I'm level, still embezzling my dreams, negligent of my schemes. I know heaven intervenes when I war with spiritual things. Ignoring amphetamines when I'm offered the better things. No substitute for the truth, and that truth is he never changed. Simple and plain, I'm a man, and I ain't got it all together. I need his son, I need his spirit, and I need him all forever. Good grief.
Now I'm set free when I feel tried. Can't let it live, gotta kill that. No matter how hopeless, I can't deny that. There's a calm blue sky over our right. So let's hope. Let's hope. My eyes are on the sky above, where the fire can't climb high enough. I'm focused on the kill that. No matter how hopeless, I can't deny that. There's a calm blue sky over our right. So let's hope. Let's hope. My eyes are on the sky above, where the fire can't climb high enough. Focus on the sky above, where the problems can't fly high enough. Oh, oh,
and we are back here on Keeping It Real. And I do definitely want to make mention of our sponsor, Cux Farm Service. If you are looking to have a quality garden, good looking lawn, we've got plenty of seeds, fertilizer, lime, chemicals, all of the supplies that you would need available out at Cux Farm Service. So I greatly encourage you to check out Cux at 844 Catawissa Road in the Lewistown Valley, just outside of Tamaqua. I've been here with Gwen today, and I'm telling you, what a joy it has been getting to know you. It has been a blast doing this show. I think the greatest thing is how richly rewarding it is for a listener's heart, even for me, who's hosting this thing, how rewarding it is for me to be able to tune in to everything that you've had to say here today as you've shared your life, shared your testimony. What do you think, or where do you think your life would be if you didn't give your life over to the Lord?
I think I would be incredibly heartbroken. I would be just as convicted and lost as I was, and I wouldn't be healed. I would know that I was still missing something, and that something was Jesus, but I wouldn't know how to get to him. I may have stayed in that lifestyle and gotten what I wanted. I may have gotten a girlfriend, may have even gotten a quote-unquote Christian girlfriend, but it still wouldn't feel okay, and I would have just kept digging myself into that hole. But God didn't let that happen. Mm-hmm. He didn't give me what I wanted. He gave me what I needed. And what I needed was his son, Jesus Christ, as my personal savior. And everything's changed for the better. My mom still isn't really in my life, but I have mother figures. I have good Christian women who are teaching me what it means to be a woman in Christ, to be a sister in Christ, to eventually someday hopefully be a wife and a mother.
And so when we talk about this change, this dramatic change that's been brought in your life, moving from an alternative lifestyle to a Jesus lifestyle, it has led to pure, limitless joy for you, has it not? Something that wasn't there, there was a lack of fulfillment before, now you are fulfilled. You can genuinely say that you are satisfied.
I am satisfied because he fills me.
Mm.
And honestly, the way I got there was I just stepped out of his way.
Mm.
I said, okay, God, put your hands on the wheel. I can't deal with this anymore on my own.
Yeah. Take over, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And I just let him lead me.
So then what would you say to someone who's convinced they were born bisexual, gay, or transgender?
I would say that a lot of people do say that. And I personally feel that way. Like, I was born with these struggles. I've had these struggles since I was little. But we are born with an incredible capacity to sin. But God gives us a way out of that. And I would say to anyone out there who struggles with the same thing I do or knows someone who does, that God still loves you, no matter how you were born. God still loved me, and I was a heathen. Mm. It wasn't just the whole bisexuality thing. It was the way I conducted myself. It was the way that I talked to God, and that I talked to God's people, and the way that I judged them, the way I judged him. But he still loved me, and he still had patience. And I would say to you that he loves you as well.
And I tell you what, Jesus, it's clear evidence that Jesus is the rock that saves a life. And it doesn't matter what the sin is. We all sin differently. I sin differently than you do, and you sin differently than your any one of your friends do. When Jesus died on the cross, he died for all sin.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why he's called the Rock of Ages. And speaking of the Rock, I want to bring your dad in here. He's been in the background here, and he's a rock in your life. He's certainly not the rock like Jesus is, but mm-hmm. You've made reference to your dad a few times here. And Dad, I tell you, what do you make of this whole journey and this transition of your daughter from an alternative lifestyle to a Jesus lifestyle in such a short amount of time?
We have an awesome God.
Mm.
There's no other explanation. There's no other thing to say about it. It is through God's grace and the blood of Christ that she's been transformed. You know, my concern as a father is people in that community, you know, are going to say that she's been brainwashed, or she's, you know, the church has done this to her, and that's not it. She's been convicted. She's been convicted of the
Spirit. I'm glad you brought that out. I think that's very important.
And I'm trying to say is, you know, she came on her own accord. You know, this wasn't, you know,
this wasn't put up on her by you or anyone else.
No, Dad didn't drag her to church.
Right.
You know, this, you know, she had choices along the way. This wasn't like, you know, my daughter's gay, I need to bring her to church.
Right.
That was not the sequence of events here.
Okay.
Okay.
So we've got to cut it off there, otherwise, you know, they're going to kick us out. But we definitely want to let everybody know you're on deck for next week.
Yes.
We got a show with you, so I definitely want to encourage everybody to tune back in to Keeping It Real back here to Magic 105.5 again next week at 8:30 a.m. Sunday morning, also to KIRradio.com. You're going to be on next dynamite show. You've got an incredible story. Gwen, thank you so much for being here. You'll come back again, I'm pretty sure, right?
Oh, yeah, I hope so.
I don't even think you've even scratched the surface of your story yet. But unfortunately, it's only an hour show. You know, mm-hmm. We can't be here for 5 hours. Otherwise, you know, the station won't even invite me back. So,
well, thank you so much for letting me speak.
Yeah, no problem. We've got one more final song here, Even If by Mercy Me. Another selection from Gwen. God bless you all real good. Again, check out my website, KIRradio.com.
They say sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. And right now I'm losing bad. Stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it'll be alright. But right now, I just can't. It's easy to say when there's nothing to bring me down. But what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my heart They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing a little faith is all I have right now. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing. It is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away if you just say the word. But Jesus, I will cling to you, come what may, 'cause I know you're able, I know you care.
You've been listening to Keeping It Real, hosted by Ollie Gann. Keeping It Real is brought to you by Cux Farm Service. Join Ollie G Sunday mornings 8:30 to 9:30 right here on Magic 105.5 WMGH.